morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. It's great to be together. Let's just open up the service in prayer, hey? Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this day. Thank you that you are here. Thank you, Lord, that you are present. We ask your blessing on each one here today. We ask a fresh revelation of who you are. I ask your blessing on Tim as he brings a message. And we just commit ourselves, our thinking, our actions all to you today, Lord. We just want to worship and praise you in your precious name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I welcome everyone and all visitors to the church and our online viewers. I have no birthdays or anniversaries this week, so if anybody's having a birthday or anniversary, congratulations. On Monday we have Drug Arm at 5:30 p.m. Tuesday we have a Vision Team Leaders meeting at 7 p.m. Thursday we have Drug Arm at 5:30 p.m. and next Sunday our 9 a.m. is our morning worship. All groups are in recess until after the school holidays. The church office will be closing early on Tuesday this week due to Lofty's funeral. And as most of you know, that Lofty Ashford passed away, and his funeral will be held at the Toro Cemetery on Tuesday the 2nd of July at 10:30 a.m. and a celebration service at 12 midday at the Baptist Church, followed with refreshments. All are welcome to support the family at this time, and I'm sure Marilyn would like some helpers as well for this time. The church office will close early on Tuesday this... Yes, I did. the office will only be open from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m, so you know. Reese and Jackie are still on leave at the moment until the 15th of July. During this time, if you have any pastoral care needs, please contact one of the elders. And if it's another matter, please contact the office. On Saturday, the 20th of July, the church will be hosting the Strongest Churches Roadshow event that is being conducted by the BAPLINK and Queensland Baptists. Marcus is looking for some helpers to help in the kitchen to serve morning tea and lunch. If you're able to help, please see Marcus for more information. And just remember our daily prayer paper notes. If you want a paper copy of the daily prayer notes, there will be some in the front foyer of the church. If none there, please ask Marcus and he can print some for you. And just a date claim was the 31st of August, a family barbecue and bonfire out at the Ashford's house at Bopple. So now the giving of tithes. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change, from James 1:17. Another priceless passage on the goodness of God, a reminder that tithes and offerings give back a part of what he's already given us. There is a red box at the front of the church and another box into the hall, and you can also give online. So thank you, Lord, for our blessings, and as we give back to you in your name, amen. And if I missed anything, just read the bulletin. Thank you.
Would like to share something with you, if you wouldn't mind. Just before we get into worship, even if you do mind, I sort of got you captive, really, haven't I? Matthew 8:23-27, out of the AMP, Amplified Version. Sounds like an insurance company then. When he got into the boat, his disciples followed him, and suddenly a violent storm arose from the sea, so that the boat was being covered by the waves, but Jesus was sleeping. I have a problem with that. And the disciples went and woke him, saying, Lord, save us, we're going to die. That was me. There's a storm arising, where's Jesus? I'm going to die. He said to them, why are you afraid, you men of little faith? Then he got up and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was at once a great and wonderful calm, a perfect peacefulness. The men wondered in amazement, saying, what kind of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? And I see in my mind Jesus sitting in the boat, or lying in the boat, back there somewhere. And Peter and the disciples standing up, holding on to the ropes tightly, looking at the waves, looking at the violence around them. Not even realize that Jesus is there, that the Son of God is there. All they can see is what's happening. around them and focusing on, they're focusing on the wrong thing, aren't they? We do that, and this week has been one of those weeks. I mean, Lenten, with 3 weeks of his ordeal out of such a simple piece of equipment. You know, it's a testimony, Lenten, that you are here now and you're still praising God. You've come out of that. We need testimonies. We need to hear them. We need to hear what God has done in our lives. Ephesians 2, 20 verse to 22 says, you are rising like the perfectly fitted stones of the temple. That's us. That's you and me. And your lives have been built up together upon the foundation laid by the apostles and prophets. And best of all, you are connected to the head cornerstone of the building. That's Jesus. The holy and anointed one, Jesus Christ himself. This entire building is under construction and is continually growing under his supervision until it rises up completed as the holy temple of the Lord himself. This means that God is transforming each one of you, us, into the Holy of Holies, his dwelling place, through the power of the Holy Spirit living in you. So we're growing. We're being built. We're being transformed day by day in all that we go through. And my thoughts were, as his child, I do not have to work to draw nearer to him. We've been grafted into him. We're part of the vine. We're already part of him. A branch doesn't have to be drawing near to the root, the vine. It's already there. He is in me. He is part of me. I'm there with him already. The Holy Spirit is in me, working in me and building me up as his dwelling place. My job isn't to stay connected. Because of Jesus, I am connected. My role is to keep my eyes on him and not on the storm. And we have the Holy Spirit. And he's given us the Holy Spirit within us to help and to guide. As we sing and as we spend this time of worship and listening to what Tim is bringing, I ask for a fresh revelation, Lord, of who you are, what our connection to you means, that we are not perfect, we are not there yet, we are growing, and your Spirit is in us, helping to build in every situation, helping to build us into your Holy of Holies, into your perfect dwelling place. And as we think of our troubles, those around us who are going through stuff, Lord, we just commit our thinking, our thoughts, our eyes to be focused on you, not on the storm that's happening around us.
Open the eyes of my heart. Focus is on body life, and one thing that as I've reflected on the events of the past week, I'm so proud of the way people within our church, apart from the normal day service, have stepped up during this difficult time. Thanks particularly to Marcus and Marilyn for their work behind the scenes in all the arrangements and the catering. For those that took part in Jack's funeral service, Tim did a great job leading us with that. Helen and Tony with the readings, and Gwen for playing the organ. And that journey of coming together is something that we will be experiencing again this week. It's interesting, isn't it, that sometimes it's in the adversity that we recognise again the value of our body life. And I think we should never take that for granted. We should never take that for granted. We should never rest on our laurels and think, I've done my bit. I'm sure that Jesus is wanting us to grow in him. I have really, really enjoyed the resource that we've been working through, our discipleship series prepared by Queensland Baptist. If you haven't been following the resources, the daily notes on that, I would strongly encourage you to do that. I remember right at the beginning, a very challenging figure of, unless you're engaging in the scriptures at least four times a week, probably you're just drifting. And that certainly was a challenge to me. And I love the way that it has the morning focus, it has the midday focus, and then it has the evening reflection time as well. So I strongly encourage you to look at that to complement the message. So this morning, Mandy Mendel is going to bring us the message. So thanks for your anticipation, Phil, but she's going to do a whole lot better job than me. She does a fantastic job, and I love her passion. I love the way that she reflects on her own experience of growing in Christian community. And I love the way that she also brings that back to the challenge within our family life, not just within our faith or church life. So I'm going to hand over to Mandy.
Back when I was first in university, I did a psychology degree. And one subject that I really enjoyed was developmental psychology, looking at the way that kids and adolescents grow. And as I was nearing the end of my degree, I thought, hey, maybe I'll do the advanced developmental psych unit. I was going through the unit guide and the assessment requirements to figure out more. And that's when I saw it. A major contributor to the final grade would be a group assignment. And I waited up because I had not had a super pleasant group assignment experience in the first developmental psych subject I did. And in the end, it did not matter how much the content interested me. I couldn't bring myself to do it. I ended up choosing a whole other subject just because I desperately wanted to avoid that group assignment. Talk about a team player, right? In my defense, being part of a group, a team, and a community, it's not easy. I think we've all probably seen it go wrong in different ways. Think about famous bands that have gone their separate ways. The Beatles, One Direction, Destiny's Child. But on a more serious note, we can probably all recall family units or friendship groups that have parted ways due to conflict or other circumstances, or churches that have split, sometimes locally, sometimes in such a way that whole new denominations have been born. Being part of community is hard. And often it can feel like we're just better off on our own. Sometimes we do find ourselves with real wounds in our heart and in our life that we've gained from being part of a community, like a family, maybe the church. Those wounds are real. And I'm sorry if you are living with wounds like that that weigh heavily on your heart and your life today. When it comes to wounds from community, it's important to find safe spaces and ways to heal when that happens. I don't believe God ever calls us to remain in places where we are truly abused or bullied, but he wants us to find places of community and of worship where we can find restoration. But a lot of people don't. My heart grieves for the increasing number of dear friends I have who have been wounded by the church and walked away. I mourn for the people who were a part of the church before COVID and since have seemingly just melted away. My heart aches as I watch people make these sporadic appearances at church, never going deep in faith or relationship until the day when those sporadic appearances end. And I look back in sadness on seasons in my own life when community among the people of God was hard, and I was tempted to let the grievances in my own heart outweigh the grace of God. There are an alarming number of reasons people give up on life in community, particularly in the church. There's a vulnerability that comes from forming new relationships that can be scary. Sometimes there's people in that community that, honestly, we just don't want to form relationships with. There can be a toll on our time and our energy, or things like our money or our skills might be asked of us. It's easy to face disillusionment when all the humanly institutions of religion become greater in our eyes than the kingdom of God. And sometimes we just face tragedies in our life that shake our faith in such a way that cause us to just let go altogether. Being part of a community, being part of the church, is challenging, and many do give up. But we can see in the passage that we'll be looking at today, Ephesians 4, verse 11 to 16, that Paul describes what happens to us when we give up on community and are removed from the body of Christ. In verse 14, he says that those who disengage from God's people are like infants who are prone to being tossed back and forth by the waves, blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. This is a pretty poetic description for someone's situation when they give up on God's community. And in simple terms, I think it means that they're going to remain immature in their faith and unfulfilled as they chase every empty promise for a meaningful life that the world might try to offer them. When people give up on the community of believers, we can see from this passage that there's this loss of purpose, a loss of assurance, of a trustworthy truth that they can stand on. But the thing is that when we lose those things as humans, usually something else will come right on in and fill that vacuum. When we disengage from God's people, from God's kingdom, we're left wide open to the risk of making our career our God. Sometimes we run to more destructive addictions to bring us comfort. Perhaps our purpose in life becomes making sure everyone has a good opinion of us. Or we make a whole new religion out of chasing fulfillment from our own accomplishments. Stepping away from God's family and community turns life into a constant chase for fulfillment, understanding, meaning, and knowledge that just seems constantly out of reach. Living a life like that doesn't mean we get to embrace freedom, God's grace. We will never find true peace and identity on that path. Being part of a community is hard, and many give up, but the alternative is not freedom. It's a life sentence of trying to be enough, trying to keep your head above the waves, trying to keep your footing as all the values and philosophies of the world try to blow you right over. But the good news is that God doesn't want us to live like that. God designed us for community, to live and learn and grow as children together in his family. This whole series is on discipleship, growing in depth and faithfulness as followers of Jesus. Someone once said that discipleship is not a solitary journey. It's walking together in the footsteps of Jesus. You might have heard that old saying, it takes a village to raise a child. Well, I think it's also true that it takes a village to raise a disciple. And so what does this village look like? Well, suffice to say, it's the church, the people of God. But Paul delves deeper into this in verse 11 and 12 of our passage. He says that Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. Now, at a surface level, it's really easy to interpret that this verse is saying Christ gave the church leaders who disciple the church and seen. And it is true that the church is blessed with leaders who are gifted to disciple, equip, challenge, stretch, and shepherd the church. This passage talks about five different offices or kinds of leaders: apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Some Christians believe that apostles and prophets were only gifted to the first century church, and we only have evangelists, pastors, and teachers today. Others believe we still have all five. Regardless of where you sit on that issue, what we can all agree on is that we have leaders as gifts from God that equip the church. That word equip in the Greek was often also used in medical settings. It meant to set things in place, like bones, to bring order and wholeness and health. But the point of these verses is not that we have leaders and it's their job and their job alone to disciple God's church. That would be a woeful misreading of this passage. It's not the leaders equipping alone that builds up the body of Christ, but also the works of service the body partakes in. Our leaders are our backstop. They're the first to arrive and the last to leave. They're the ones burdened with the heaviest and darkest secrets. They carry a responsibility to train and equip the church. All of that means that, yes, they are uniquely gifted, called, and positioned to disciple us. And as a side note, if you haven't loved on, honored, thanked, prayed for, or smiled at your leaders recently, can I encourage you to do so? But it's also our job to raise up disciples, the whole church. In this verse, we're taught that leaders equip, but then Christ's people get to work. And all of that together leads to the building up of the body, or in other words, discipleship. This makes all the sense in the world when we look at the New Testament as a whole. We see multiple letters that talk about the importance of every person in the church using the gifts that they've been given by God to bless the body. We read in Corinthians that metaphor of the church as a literal body that needs all the different parts to function as it was designed and intended to. Outside of scripture, I want you to think about major movements of healing and growth for humanity. The human rights movement in the USA might have been spearheaded by the tenacity and passion of people like Martin Luther King Jr. and Rosa Parks, but it also needed the tireless efforts of thousands of others. Significant, healthy communities and movements cannot lean on the merits of the few, but are dependent on the commitment and strength of the whole. God wants the many, not just the few, to be the ones building up his church. There will be some that are granted leadership opportunities and have special responsibilities to equip the church. But each and every one of us has a responsibility within our own village to contribute towards its growth. That's to say that under God, every villager has a vital role to play in all of us growing as disciples. Paul says in verse 16 that it's from our God and Savior Jesus Christ that the whole body, joined together and held by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. We just mentioned Paul's famous metaphor of the church as a literal body. In every room where this message is being heard, there will be ears, hands, feet, and hearts, all different kinds of people with different talents and different gifts, all unified under Jesus as the head of that body. You've probably heard the church described as a family because it's true. We have grandparents of the faith in our midst with life and faith experience to learn from. We have young adults booming with energy that are the powerhouses of many a local church ministry. We have children who remind us of the importance of delight, the simple things of faith, the importance of change and growth for the future. For each of us to determine what role we can play as villagers raising up disciples, I think there are three helpful things we can consider. What are our unique spiritual giftings, our skills, and our circumstances? It's important to know what spiritual gifts God has given you. And if you've put your faith in him, then you have been given those gifts. If you aren't sure what your spiritual gifts might be, then talk with your pastor, a trusted friend, a small group. You could try one of those online spiritual gift tests, and while these are a helpful place to start, don't let them be the final authority. Notice what comes easily to you, or what you're really passionate about. Maybe it's welcoming people, and your gift is hospitality. Maybe it's explaining the gospel to others, and you have a gift in evangelism. Maybe your heart beats for teaching, explaining scripture, or discerning the hearts of people and situations with an ability that's beyond your human abilities. Beyond spiritual gifts, you will all also have skills, musicianship, financial wisdom, business degrees, cooking, being able to relate to children, gardening. These aren't all necessarily gifts from the Holy Spirit, but a part of the unique self that God knit together in your mother's womb. These hobbies, these expertise, these are things that you can use in the village you're a part of to help it grow and build itself up. But when we think about each of us having a vital part to play in our village, I think it's also helpful to think about what our life circumstances are in that season. Participating in community life will always require some sacrifice of us. I'm not saying that our life circumstances are a reason to just bow out of the role we could be playing in our church life. I think we should flip that perspective on its head and instead ask ourselves, what does our current season of life empower us to do for God's kingdom? If your circumstances right now mean that you're young, you're full of energy, flexible work and study schedule, then that's going to give you an opportunity to play a role in your village that others can't. If you have young kids, then those circumstances mean that the major role you're going to play is raising up those gorgeous little people to know Jesus, teaching them what it means to be disciples of Jesus in community. To figure out the vital role that you can play in a village raising up disciples, consider: what are the spiritual gifts God has given you? What are the skills and talents that you have? And what opportunities can you take up based on the circumstances of your life right now? These are personal questions with personal answers that I can't lay out for each of you through this message, but they are questions that you have to ask yourself as part of God's church. You are one part of a village full of disciples that each have their own important work to do. And you might want to ask me at this point, Maddie, why should I bother? Why should I bother figuring out what my gifts are, what I'm skilled at, what my circumstances are? Why should I bother figuring out what I can contribute to my church community, my village life? Well, because when we all play our part, that's when we grow deeper and stronger and more passionate and more faithful. Paul's explained for us in this passage that we have leaders who shepherd and equip us, but then we, the people of God, disciples living in village life, take up the mantle through works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. Paul is so clear here in saying that it's only in village life that we grow in maturity and unity and knowledge. We grow through our communication and our relationships. We do that through service. We do it through worship, by being together, all parts of a community of faith. Being part of that life give us safeguards and support on our discipleship journey. Disciples in village life have helped remembering their purpose, refocusing their priorities. When we're in community, we benefit from constant reminders of who we are as children of God and what our purpose is, to love him and make him known. We're inspired as we gather together on Sundays and learn. We're reminded of that inspiration when we get together in small groups during the week to study God's word and pray. Disciples in village life also have the blessing of access to godly friends and mentors. This means that when we face hard times or we need advice, we can be encouraged to look to God. We can find people who will pray for us, walk with us, and point our eyes to Jesus. Disciples in village life are also surrounded by a family who should pick us up when we fall. A good village will know that we're not perfect and will have grace for us through our mistakes and our learning. This isn't a license for us to just do whatever we want because our community should just forgive us and embrace us. But as we endeavor to follow God with everything that we have, we will inevitably have moments where we fail. And using Paul's language, our village should speak the truth in love, gather around us in unity, and help us carry on. My own journey of discipleship is full of stories where being part of God's family has helped me grow closer to God rather than being swayed or distracted by the world. Sometimes this was as simple as someone from church lending me a book that helped me grow in my understanding of God or ministry. So many times I've been invited into families' homes to sit at their dinner tables. Christians older than me have given me advice, and I've been able to encourage Christians younger than me to chase after Jesus too. I've had times when I felt so discouraged or disappointed, but I've walked into church on a Sunday and been reminded of what really matters. I've gone through dark seasons, and I've had friends, leaders, home groups pray for me. I've needed a village as I've grown as a disciple. My faith would not be where it is today without my brothers and sisters. And I pray that those whose lives I've invested in over the years feel the same way. It takes a village to raise a disciple because that's how God intended it to be. He puts us in community where we all have a role to play. And when we do that together, we will be grown deeper and stronger in our faith than we ever could apart. So while it is not easy being part of community, I hope we can see that God has designed his children for it. It takes a village to raise a disciple, and each one of you is uniquely placed in your village with a role to play that will grow you in faith and maturity and also bless the discipleship journeys of those around you. This passage and this message invites us to ask some honest questions of ourselves and also gives us a chance to respond in really clear ways. Maybe today the Holy Spirit is convicting you about how engaged you are with the village of disciples around you. You have an opportunity today to take one small step to be more engaged with the community of believers around you. Maybe that means just attending church more regularly. Maybe it's joining a small group or serving in a ministry. Perhaps it's inviting someone at church out for coffee who you'd like to get to know more, or asking someone to mentor you in the faith. If you've been walking a solitary discipleship journey, what's one thing you can do this week to bring that journey into community? I hope you've been encouraged today to see that there is nothing but blessing for you when you take that path. But I also sense that for a lot of people, you're really involved in village life. But maybe these days it doesn't feel like it's so much about rich relationships and making disciples. You just feel busy. I hear time and time again as I speak with Christians and churches all across our state, our churches are busier than ever. And many are becoming exhausted and even disillusioned by a lack of fruit from all that activity. I pray today you might take a chance to just take a bit of stock on your village life. If you're feeling overcommitted or stuck, I pray the Holy Spirit would lead you towards a revitalization of your heart for village life, that you wouldn't feel led to give up, but would instead invest deeper into discipleship yourself and discipling others. I pray you'd find space for meaningful relationships in community and a way to serve the body that excites you and fills you. Our goal should never be to just do more stuff in church because it's what we're supposed to do. Our goal should be to grow as faithful disciples of Jesus in community, encouraging our brothers and sisters to do the same. The way we engage in relationships and service should stem from that heart and motivation. I also felt led to encourage the families that are listening to this message because your discipleship village has two levels: in the local church, and in your home. To all the mums and dads out there, I trust that parenting regularly challenges you in your faith. Your kids, without even knowing it, helping or challenging you into more faithful followers if you take the chance. But you have a beautiful responsibility to them, to lead them towards Jesus. It's so important that that mission is part of your family's DNA. Sunday school, while helpful, cannot be the only thing discipling your kids week to week. Would growing your family's spiritual health be just as much a priority as their physical, mental, and emotional health? If you have no idea where to start, then we've put together family resources for this series, which would be an excellent place for you to look. It's never too late to introduce some discipleship into your family life. Let your kids see you reading your Bible, pray and study together as a family, serve together in church. But while this magnificent responsibility is yours, you're not alone. I hope and I pray that the church communities you're a part of will play a beautiful role in the spiritual journey of your kids. And so church, gather around the families in your midst, pray for them, encourage the parents, bless the children. When we do this well, the next generation of disciples grow up strong and know that they are loved in their village. If we want to grow in this life and experience abundance and peace and joy, then walking with Jesus is the only place that that can be found. It's in our discipleship to Jesus that we live out our true purpose and find meaning in this life. But if we try to walk with Jesus on our own, we will miss out. And others will miss out because they aren't blessed by what we can bring into their lives. As we serve together, as we live together in meaningful relationships, as we encourage and challenge each other, we will grow. It takes a village to raise disciples who are mature, steadfast, growing, loving, and wise. So what's your part to play? I would love to pray for you, for your church, as you walk out this journey of following Jesus together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we acknowledge that community life can be tricky, that we are all broken people. And we confess the times in our life where we have not been loving, where we have not been true or understanding. But Lord, we just pray that this message from your word today would encourage us to take a step back towards community. We can see, Heavenly Father, that you have made us for this life. That community is meant to be a place where we can grow and mature, but where we can also help others on that journey as well. Would each person hearing this message understand better the place that you have for them in their village life? I pray that they would find a real sense of energy and fullness from that pursuit. Lord, I pray that relationships would be deepened in all of our QB churches, that we would walk with each other well, lifting each other up along the journey. God, we thank you that you love so that we can love others. And so we draw from that well, asking Holy Spirit that you would help us every step of the way. And it is in the name of Jesus, our beautiful Savior, that we pray all these things today. Amen.
Well, hello. I'm Celia Botza. I'm one of the elders, and Tim has asked me to lead us into communion. And coming out of that message this morning, God laid a verse on my heart that often we don't often hear, but it's directly connected to the time of communion. It's from John chapter 12. And if you have your Bible there, you might like to look at these verses. John chapter 12, beginning at verse 23. Jesus said, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed, but if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, Well, anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honour the one who serves me. And I have here a few ears of wheat. The seeds have long gone, but the single seed or husk that would represent a seed is so tiny, you wouldn't be able to see it. But the ears you can see. And I think that's what we were hearing today. If you remain alone, you don't invest in the community around you, then you can be insignificant. And you can be easily blown away by any wind that takes you off your feet and tries to convince you that something else is the way to receive satisfaction. But if we grow together in the village of God's family, then we know that others around us, as we invest our lives into our faith community, will be growing, and we will grow to be like each other and to be like Jesus. So as we gather around the communion table this morning, let's just offer a prayer that we will be obedient and open to what he's been saying to us today. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you don't want us to be alone. Lord, you say in your word that you set the lonely in families. And Lord, we pray that this family will be a welcoming and embracing and affirming family, Lord, for all who need to find you here. Lord, we know we've all come from different paths on our faith journey. But Lord, we don't want anybody to be continuing their journey alone and with a sense of aimlessness and distraction and uncertainty. Lord, we long for people to be gathered together in you. Lord, we know that each one of us has our limitations and our failures, Lord, but it's only as we look to Jesus and that you have removed the things that are wrong to restore the things that are right, that we will find growth and progress and not keep going round in the same circle, making the same errors and having the same failures. Lord, we acknowledge that we may have other errors and other failures, Lord, but we just thank you that this can be part of our growing and our learning together, Lord. We don't have to wait to be perfect. We just need to look to Jesus. So, Lord, as we gather around your table this morning, we just ask for the sense of your presence, Lord, that your spirit will be speaking to each one about how we can be involved in your village, Lord, and involved in your destiny for each one of us, Lord. You've made us unique. You've made us different, but you've also made us to harmonize, Lord. And we thank you for this and the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Could I ask the stewards to come forward, please? It's our custom here to take the bread as we receive it and eat it. And for me, that always symbolises this is the body of Christ. And as we receive the bread, we are acknowledging that each of us has started our journey as individuals and our encounter with God. But then as we take the wine or the juice, we take it together to symbolise that now we are united in one. And you don't need to be a member here. If this is your first time, you're quite welcome to participate because the table is a welcoming table. And so we just offer this time now for each of us to make our connection with God and our connection with one another. Thank you. Jesus said, "Take and drink and remember me until I come." Let's say, until he comes. Until he comes. Thank you, Lord, that we can draw close to you, and it's your desire to draw close to us, that we can go forward drawing closer to each other and taking your encouragement, Lord, to grow into disciples who follow you as a village. Amen.
Coming this morning, which by itself is a reminder of the importance of community. It'd be pretty lonely if I was the only one here. So thank you for coming and sharing. We invite you to come out and share a cup of tea or coffee and some light refreshments. And we thank you too for our online family. Pray that you have a great week. Let's just sing that chorus one more time.